But officially, I'm starting right now. All right. How many brought a Bible today? Oh, yeah. Say, I can have. Everything this Bible says I can have. I can be everything this Bible says I can be. And I can do. In fact, today, I think I'm going to start doing this. Because it'll really be well with my soul. Amen, amen. I basically only have one verse for today. And based on the time that it is, aren't you glad? Zechariah, and I even got a little PowerPoint here, and my wife helped me with this. This is the first time I had a PowerPoint blank here. But my lovely bride, and I told her today, Reverend Connie Anderson. Sue. Reverend Connie Sue Anderson. A rare find. You know, when a man finds a treasure in a field, he buys the whole field just to get the treasure. It has cost me a lot for this woman. How many's ever heard of Michael Bolton? When a man loves a woman, he'll give his last dime, you know, that type of thing. But, you know, when something's worth it, you'll pay for it. Amen? So anyway, thank God for my woman today to help me with this. Zechariah chapter 8. This is probably, you probably have never heard this verse before in your entire life. It's one of those verses that, who in the world can preach on that? And I thought, I can today. Hallelujah. So Zechariah chapter 8, verse 19, it says, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the fast of the fourth." Now, month there is in italics in your Bible. So therefore, I just want you to realize that doesn't necessarily mean the fourth month. So you'll start calculating what's the fourth month. Well, let me see. Does the year start at Passover? Does it start at trumpets? God, I still can't figure that one out, you know. It still bounces back and forth. So you start counting months. And yeah, well, it doesn't say that. It just says the fast of the fourth. And of the what? Fifth, and the fast of the seventh and the fast of the tenth shall be to the house of Judah. All right, everybody say fasting. Fasting. Okay. The fast, everybody say four fasts. Okay, I don't even like one, but we're talking four. Everybody say four. But it says to the house of Judah. Doesn't say to the house of maybe even Issachar. Ooh. Says to the house of Judah, it will be joy and gladness. So if you're happy about this, you're in the tribe of Judah. If you're not happy about this, you may be one of those other tribes. Joy and gladness and cheerful feasts. Wow. All right. Therefore, love the truth and peace. So a fast is going to kind of shut off the flesh and get you focused on truth, which will bring peace. So there is a result of the fast. Now I want to read three more verses to you. It says, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts," verse 20, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, it shall yet come to pass that there shall come people and inhabitants of many cities." Now that was almost prophesied this morning before I got to this message. Everybody say, people are coming.
Yeah, people are coming.
And the inhabitants of one city will go to another. Okay. Okay. So, you know, people that go to church in another city is going to start going to another city. Thank you for your enthusiasm.
Yeah.
And it says, let us go speedily, because they've got a nicer nursery than the church that I go to. Now, let us go speedily to pray before the Lord and to seek the Lord of hosts. I will go also. What are these people going to do? They're going to pray. We are going to turn every Wednesday night into prayer. Sweet hour of prayer. Now, basically, God already gave us a taste of what that can be like. Could you not pray with me 1 hour? Can people come to a Wednesday night service and do nothing but pray and worship and pray and worship and pray and worship? That's not going on out there. That's not very seeker-friendly and visitor-friendly. Yeah. Are you with me? Yeah. But people will come from other cities for that. If they're really hungry for God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Here we go. How many thinks this is a great verse so far?
Yeah.
All right, next slide. There's five reasons for these fasts. The fast in Zechariah chapter 8. Now, this comes from Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, which comes the Mammonites. He is known as Rambam. Now, in Jewish literature, they compare this guy right here with Moses. They say there was Moses, and then there was Rabbi Moshe. There was Moshe in Exodus, and there is Rabbi Moshe. They said he was one of the most holy, dedicated, consecrated rabbis the world has seen. And so many times when they refer to anything or they want to go back and find out what the belief system really is, they will go and read the readings of Rambam. They called him Rambam. Aren't you glad that I'm just Bam, not Ram too? Amen. But I think it's great. So anyway, what he has to say about this Zechariah chapter 8, this is what he says about it. Are you ready? He says that each of these fasts commemorates the leading up to the destruction of the Holy Temple. Each one of these fasts commemorates the leading up to the destruction of the Holy Temple. The first one was the tablets of the Ten Commandments were broken. When the Ten Commandments are broken, what happens? That leads up to the destruction of the Holy Temple. Are you okay? All right. The second was the offering in the era of the first Beis HaMikdash, in the era of the first Holy Temple, the offering of the daily sacrifice ceased. The offering of the daily sacrifice. If the daily offering ceases, well, it destroys the temple. In the war leading up to the destruction of the second Holy Temple, the walls of Jerusalem were breached. When the walls are breached, it leads to the destruction of the Holy Temple. Yay? This guy called Apostemus, sounds pretty close to apostasy, doesn't it? The wicked, he burnt a Torah scroll which stopped the Sabbath teaching. When the Sabbath teaching in the Torah is destroyed, it does what? It destroys the temple. And the fifth one, the same guy, he erected an idol in the sanctuary. When you put an idol in the sanctuary, it is the abomination that causes what? Desolation for the Spirit of God to leave, which destroys the holy temple. So what do we got? Well, we've got five things here that what? Destroy the holy temple. Let me just say it this way. The greasy grace message has taken the Ten Commandments out of the church, out of the court system. Well, then what does that do? Well, then that destroys the holy temple. Yeah. We don't have to go by those Ten Commandments anymore. Well, that leads up to the destruction of the holy temple. The offering of the daily sacrifice. Well, I go to church on Christmas and Easter. I go to church, you know, when I can make it. Well, if it's not a daily in the temple, that destroys the holy temple. You okay? The next thing, the walls are broken down. Yeah, let me Let me be really clear. You know, the church without walls. Doesn't that sound so wonderful? Well, as soon as you establish a church without walls, it will destroy the holy temple. Why? Because every snake, every false belief, every false god has easy access into the church. Oh, we're a church without walls. We go everywhere. You can have walls and still go everywhere. There's doors. Do you understand how things sound good? But pretty soon you're compromising, and pretty soon you're greasy grace, and pretty soon the temple is destroyed. The Torah scroll. Well, we don't believe in the Torah anymore, the law of Moses. The Torah, we don't believe in the Torah. We got a new covenant, as if Jesus came and wrote a whole new thing down. Well, then we don't have a Sabbath teaching. We don't have the Torah teaching. We don't learn Torah. In other words, we don't learn how to love God and love how to love people. What's that do? It destroys the temple. Getting anything out of this so far? And then this last one, an idol in the sanctuary. I mean, you got Christmas trees, you got homosexual bishops, you've got, I mean, this is in the sanctuary, friends. This is in the sanctuary. Now, here's the trick of the enemy. I got more slides here, but I got the preach on me. All right, so here's how the devil works. He starts saying that Israel is going to rebuild the temple. Okay, I think I do have a slide on this. Okay, let's go to another one. The Holy Temple today. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Know you not that in the last days they will build a temple in Jerusalem so God can dwell? Is anybody paying any attention? Is that what it says? How many? But do you understand? Everybody believes that. Who said? No, these five things leads up to what? Destruction of what? The Holy Temple. Okay, is this sanctuary here the Holy Temple? Paul made it very clear. Know ye not that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If any man defile the temple of God, what temple is he talking about? You. Him shall God love and bless because you're so stupid and ignorant. No, he'll destroy it. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. I mean, he keeps saying it. So it's not like you should miss it. And then later on in verse 19, he goes on and says, what? I love Paul. This has been one of my most favorite verses for 37 years. What? Don't you know you're the temple of the Holy Ghost? What is your stinking problem? Or I don't know, maybe he didn't say it that way. King James Version. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? Everybody say Holy Temple. Which is in you, which you have of God. You are not your own. For you are bought with a price. Who owns the Holy Temple? God owns the Holy Temple. Therefore, what? Glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which belong to God. Are we doing any good? Well, then what destroys the temple? Do you remember? Oops. Going a little too fast there. What destroys the temple? You not keeping the commandments. Where? In your temple. Well, I just couldn't do the Sabbath. Well, you just destroyed God's holy temple. All right, here's the trick of the enemy. Well, in the last days, Israel is going to rebuild the temple. We're going to get back to the daily sacrifices. And finally, God can come. What's that do? That puts off the daily sacrifice. That puts off the Sabbath. That puts everything off until a future date. Meanwhile, the devil has destroyed the real holy temple for all this time. Thank you for your enthusiasm. So what do we need to do? Well, you need to put the commandments back in your temple. Yes? You need to put your Sabbath Torah learning back into the temple. But how do you do that? Well, you just have to log onto the website for 25, 35 minutes and put the Torah back into the temple. How do you get the Torah into the temple? Just listen to the Torah reading every week. Are we doing good? Walls broken down. Well, church without walls, they let everything in. In this place, I built walls in here. I'm bouncing back and forth here, but I just, you know, trying to pick it up along the way. I kick snakes out, don't let snakes in. I don't know if you know that or not. I butt heads with goats. Goats come in this sanctuary, butt bishop. I got bigger horns. Rambam. I am Rambam after all. Amen. I take up snakes, vipers, hypocrites. I know how to deal with them. I got walls. Why? So that you can be protected. Amen. But you got to put some walls up yourself. Well, you got to let the walls down. You got to let everybody in. No, you don't. You got a door. Witness. I have no problem with that, but you need to protect yourself. It's called put on the whole armor of God. You need to be protected from the wiles of the devil. All right, I'm preaching again here. All right, idols in the sanctuary. We took the Christmas tree out of here years ago. But you need to take it out of your own life. Now, I think last week I brought up, or when was it, that you know, you're going to have to get the Christian band idols out of your life also. You see, I got a few more comments on that than I did the last time I preached it. But, you know, I'm sorry. Some of these Christian bands, they're coming out as gay. They're coming out as don't even believe in God. They're coming out as atheists now. Yeah. And you've been sitting worshiping and giving them your tithes and offerings. Make a melody in your heart. Put the song of the Lord in your heart. You don't need some Christian band to put it in there. Amen. All right, so what else do I have here? I thought I had another scripture up there, but I don't know. Anyway, Romans 12:1. I wonder what happened to that. Okay, Romans 12:1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present what? Your bodies. A what? A living sacrifice. What? Holy. Holy temple. Acceptable unto God. Which is your reasonable spiritual worship, reasonable service. Yeah. That you may prove what is that, what? Good, perfect will of God. Yeah. Well, what is the perfect will of God? You have the Ten Commandments in your life. Right. You're daily offering up the sacrifice of praise. You're daily becoming the temple of God. Every day you are the temple of God. Every day, God's going to dwell in me and express himself through me every day. Yeah. Putting the daily sacrifice back into the temple. So you got to get rid of the mindset of, I come to the temple. You are the temple. Yeah. Well, I come to church on Sunday, and I worship God on Sunday from 10 to 12. If I'm in the ministry of helps, I'm there half the day. Dear God. Well, that's just one day. What are you doing on Monday? See, it should be 16 hours on Monday that you're the temple of God also. But that's putting the daily sacrifice back in. Everybody say the daily sacrifice. What are these fasts for? Remembering, commemorating those things that lead up to the destruction of the holy temple. So we need to fast, in other words, give up, things that destroy the temple. And we have to be remembered of that. We have to remind ourselves of those things. So present your body. How many wants to do that? How many wants to be the holy temple? All right, here we go. Today, I want to, my message title is The Fasts of the Past. Everybody say The Fasts of the Past. Now, I'm not a novice on fasting. Here we go. 1981, I went on a 14-day fast. I was in this house across the driveway and an upstairs room, which was my office. BAM International ran from that little upstairs corner office up there. That was, but not BAM International, Bill Anderson Ministries Incorporated. I went on a 14-day fast. I had 14 wisdom verses on my wall behind me. Every day I memorized a verse on wisdom. I fasted 14 days for wisdom. No food, no drink. 14 days, I wanted wisdom more than food. I read where Solomon asked for wisdom. And God gave him not only wisdom, but he gave him wealth. So I thought that sounds like a good promise. So that's what I went after. From that 14-day fast, Bill Anderson Ministries Incorporated was born, or birthed, as it were, okay? And the gospel of the kingdom was the wisdom that was imparted to me. At that time, nobody was preaching the gospel of the kingdom. It was not heard of. I mean, I was the weirdo on the block. What in the world are you talking about? And then God would send me a Robert Berger from Peru, and we'd sit and talk all night long about the gospel of the kingdom. And he too was saying, man, I think we're onto something here. And then a few years later, Bishop Earl Polk, and I can't think of the other guy's name, that sat down with him, and two men in their Bible, and they talked about the gospel of the kingdom. And I said, thank God, somebody else that is least important is talking about this too.
Mel Bailey,
thank you very much. I mean, that's years ago. I'm just talking about years ago. But God revealed to me on this 14-day fast the gospel of the kingdom. It was not being preached. The gospel of the kingdom changed everything in my life. What is the gospel of the kingdom? The rule and reign of God in your life. And out of that became, let the word become life in your life. What's the devil come try to do? Destroy your temple, where the gospel of the kingdom is supposed to be in. In 1983, God called me on a 40-day fast. And God called me. You don't want to do this without God. I've told some of my ministers that 40 days is one heaven of a long time. But on that 40-day fast, and by the way, on the 14-day fast in 1981, in the 2 years following that, three people was raised from the dead. I raised three people from the dead. One of them was my sister, and she worked with me in the ministry and ran a puppet for 1 year after that. So it's not about, you know, something I prayed. I mean, I had documented proof. And Sue's shaking her head. She remembers back then. Amen. One guy came back into his body in a casket out at Port Sanilac. People saw his eyes open, see his eyes close. He came back, his flesh got warm, soft. If you have ever touched a corpse, they're like a board, it's cold. It's like a cold iron wood feel to it. His flesh softened. I saw his eyes open and close. He came back into his body, according to, is it Jude, and accepted the Lord and then died again. They had harvested some of his organs, so there was it would have taken more miracle even for him to live. But more people saw that than just me. That's the second one. Another one, That was in Port Huron. A baby died in the hospital. They called me. They used to gossip about me and talk about me forever. But when their baby was dying in the hospital, I was the one they called in the middle of the night. Just saying. I said, "Where's your pastor?" And they said, "Well, we believe in your prayers." Okay, so I get up, I take a shower, I drive to the Port Huron Hospital, I walk in, and this baby's on tubes, this baby is dying, and so I walk up and I pray for the baby, and it does die. I thought, thank you. So there was that little monitor. I don't know if you've been in the hospital with that little blub thing going. But anyway, it quit going blub blub blub, and it just did one of those flatline things. And that's not a good feeling. So I'm looking at that, and I'm looking at the baby, and then the nurses start looking at me, and they start giving me this look like, it's time for you to leave. And I just mentioned this, to Greg. Wednesday night, I said, immediately the gift of faith operated in my life. You can't work this up. It's no different than a word of knowledge or prophecy or anything else. The gift of faith happened to me at that moment. This is coming out of a 14-day fast. Everybody say 14-day fast for wisdom. That's what I was after. I'm standing there, and it's like a cork under my neck. I don't know how to explain it any other than that. It's like this cork pulled out and all the doubt and unbelief totally drained out of me. I mean, I couldn't doubt anything. I could have walked on water. I could have probably flew around the room. I mean, I could not doubt. That's the only way that I can explain it. So I turn to the nurse and say, the baby will not die but live. And her response is, the baby is dead. I said, no, you don't understand. The baby will live and not die. And she said, the baby is dead. This went on, and I watched that second hand on the clock. Click. Click. I mean, it was like, oh my God. I mean, a minute was like an hour, and then 3 minutes was like 10 hours. And I mean, it is this, how are we going to get this crazy preacher out of this room? I mean, yeah. But I'm thinking, no, I am so compassionately trying to explain to him. No, honest, the baby will live and not die. I mean, I'm not trying to be weird. I'm just telling you what I know. And they're saying, well, we don't want to be weird either, but we're trying to tell you what we know. And so then, you know, as the clock ticks, they said, even if the baby lived now, it would be a vegetable. You know, that's the vocabulary they use. And then all of a sudden, blip, 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 and the baby came back to life. Now the doctors really want me out of there, as if I was the problem. You know, anyway, a few years later, I got to thank you for that. Just saying, it took a few years, I guess. Anyway, they said that the child was borderline genius, not a vegetable. This is a 14-day fast. This is called the gospel of the kingdom, the rule and reign of God. What did that restore? In 1983, 40-day fast, New Covenant Living Outreach Center. My sister did die during this one. Could we have raised her from the dead again? She had done her deal. She was ready to go. She didn't want to come back. I mean, knows there's a time when you can't talk me in it. I'm out of here. New Covenant Living Outreach Center, a.k.a. Bill Anderson Ministries, but it became a.k.a. New Covenant Living Outreach Center because it was a little uncomfortable for people to say, where do you go to church? I go to Bill Anderson Ministries Incorporated Church. You probably have the same problem today. Where do you go to church? BAM. What is BAM? You know, it's not, you know, I'm sorry, it's not Faith Family Fellowship. All right, so on that 40-day fast, New Covenant Living outreach center was birthed out of a 40-day fast. Are you with me? What did I do? Well, I restored the laver in the tabernacle. The tabernacle was now being built. I removed idols. I got rid of the Christmas. I got rid of the Easter. I got rid of all of these idol worship. I began to build the tabernacle. I started teaching on fivefold ministry and elders and deacons and helps ministry. 1 million people, everybody say 1 million people, heard the gospel of the kingdom after that 40-day fast. I stood face to face to over 1 million people and preached the gospel of the kingdom. That's like 30 nations heard the gospel. I'm not new to this. The fasts of the past. I didn't do this one day because I decided to do something. God called me on a fast, and the result of that was. The result of that was. Now, okay, move along. All right. How many is starting to get the picture? All right, so I started removing the idols. Remember the things that destroy the holy temple? Well, I started putting the things back in that did destroy the holy temple. I put the things back in to rebuild the holy temple. Yes? 2001, I went on another 40-day fast. This particular one here was not without great discussion with the Lord. Because I still had visions of losing 40 pounds on the last one. Still had visions of being lightheaded. Still had visions of, you know, all of that stuff. And but I said, yes, Lord. So I began to restore the teacher, the prophet, the psalmist, to restore the candlestick and the table and the golden altar. BAM University was born. I was ordained a bishop. I got my doctorate's degree. I began to restore the Ten Commandments. I came out with an entire teaching on the Ten Commandments of grace then and now and started really hammering on that. I didn't just start teaching the Ten Commandments lately. Some of you just finally heard it, but I taught it a long time ago. Right. What was I trying to do? Without the commandments, the temple would be destroyed. So I had to restore that. Do you understand what I'm saying? All right. 2014, another 40-day fast. I didn't argue as long on this one, because I knew there would be no sense of doing it anyway, you know? So another 40-day fast in 2014. In 2014, BAM International started to restore the Torah and the Sabbath. Started restoring the Torah and the Sabbath. The apostle, restore the holy place, the Ark of the Covenant, where the Torah is, the commandments are, the Aaron's rod that budded. And I also restored the wall. Everybody say, I restored the wall. Everybody say, I restored the wall. How did I do that? Well, in 2014, God gave me a vision, the revelation, however you want to say it, is He gave me a revelation of 2014, okay, restore the wall. But in 2014, it was an apostolic outlook, and God gave me a 3.5-year vision. Everybody say 3.5 years. I saw today 3.5 years ago. Just understand, I saw today 3.5 years ago. I've had people over the years, you know, well, we're just praying for you, Bishop, that God will just lead you and guide you. My response is, and I'm praying for that manipulative witchcraft spirit on you. Because I've got more vision today than you can ever handle in a lifetime, and you're praying for vision for me? I'm sorry, get a life. Let me try this one more time. Any person that prays for me for vision, is all they're saying is, God, please show Bishop what I want. That's all it means. I've already told you what God wants. And if you say no to that, then go somewhere else. Go manipulate some other preacher someplace. I don't need vision for today. 3.5 years ago, I had vision for today. It hasn't changed. And for anyone to just see what I'm talking about here, you'll be able to go back and say, my God, when he fasted 40 days 3.5 years ago, he saw it today. It ought to make you think, I better get with the program today. You say you being arrogant? I'm talking about Zechariah chapter 8, verse 19. I'm talking about Rambam. I'm talking about the Holy Temple. I'm talking about you. You say, well, I thought you were talking about you, Bishop. No, I'm talking about you. It's not about me. I've been around the block. This move that's coming right now is not about me. This move that God wants to do is you. You're the Holy Temple. So let's look at this again. 2014, I give the apostolic outlook that God is drawing a line. He's drawn a line between sheep and goats, sons and slaves, light and darkness, wise virgins, foolish virgins. Do you understand that that's all the church? That has nothing to do with the world. In 2015, the apostolic outlook was God was cutting on the line. In other words, it was starting to get pretty obvious. And we lost 3 goats that year. I can name them to you, or you can look around and say, oh, that's what they were, apparently. Yeah, that's what they were. But, Bishop, that's the vocabulary. Well, I'm sorry, but God told you that a year before that happened. Should have been warned. Talked about Team 70, talked about Gideon's 300, talked about some of these different things. You got your head stuck in the water. Are you with me? No, the only way you're going to get it is look up and lap the water like a dog, Gideon's 300. Or you're not going to be a part of this. If you're just looking at your reflection in the water, taking a selfie, God's cutting on the line. 2016, what did I tell you? God's separating the pages. That's when the wall is totally built. What is he separating? Snakes, vipers, hypocrites. You can't get in here. I'm going to have an usher at the door to stop you at the door because you're not coming in and biting my people. I restore the wall. This is a safe place. You come in here, this is a safe place. I'm not letting anybody in this pulpit that's going to preach garbage. This is a safe place. 3 amens, I might go on. Separating the pages. This is just the church. Judgment begins where? At the house of God. God's not dealing with the world yet. Let me give you a little hint. He's about ready to. How many knows it's been a little tough on your part? How many's had that little scissors just go really close to you? Woo! Guess I better get in on that page a little farther over here. How many's been amazed that, man, I didn't know that they were a goat. I didn't know they were just believers and not knowers. I didn't know they were foolish virgins. I didn't know they didn't have any oil in their lamp. They looked lit up on Sunday. Yeah, but they were lit up on something else on Saturday. But God knows. And he's the one that's doing this separation. Are you still with me? Trying to make this fun. 2017. Everybody, he's talking about today. Did you go on another 40-day fast? Well, God just told me about another 40-day fast, which would make it, how many? 4. Shundai and a bow tie and ride in my Honda, I begin to speak in tongues more than y'all. And I prayed about this for like a week. I said, you know, Lord, you know, I will do this, but really? Because it's one heaven of a long time, you know? And, you know, Oh, do you want it now? Or maybe leading up to trumpets? That'd be a good time. And then finally, I got the revelation of what he was saying. Because I was saying, Lord, I flow in the gifts. I mean, did you see me flow in the gifts today? I mean, I've preached to 1 million people around the world. But what else you want me to do? I mean, what's there more for me to do? Walk on water? I just, you know, just wait till next week. The water will freeze and I can walk on it again. Raise the dead? I don't know. Some people need to stay dead. I don't know. You know, I mean, what else? It's like, God, this isn't about me. And he says, that's exactly right. The move that I want now is the body. I say the move that I want now is the body. So I felt quite relieved to understand that this 40-day fast was not for me. But he was giving you that opportunity. Judah, I heard Judah say yay. I heard one Judah. Nothing from the tribe of Issachar, I don't hear. <laughs> 2017, what's this about? Restoring the daily sacrifice, the last piece for the glory of God to fill this temple. How many is keeping the commandments? I mean, he's messed up once in a while, but you at least got the confess your sin thing down. Amen. How many is getting the Torah in your life every week? Yes? How many's got the wall finally up a little bit? Yeah, I'm saying no to this stuff. Amen? What's left? The daily sacrifice. I've been bringing you right up to this. Say, why is Bishop preaching what he is? Because 3.5 years ago, I knew where I was trying to get you to. And systematically, I've been trying to get you there. This is the greatest moment of your life. Yeah. Do you understand? This is why you were called into the kingdom for such a time as this. So you have to restore the daily sacrifice in your life. You have to get up in the morning and say, I belong to you today. Yeah. You enter his gates with thanksgiving, you enter his courts with praise, which is your temple. Yeah. And you say, today, whatever you want to manifest in your temple today, I want. Yeah. But you've learned the cool thing is you get to do what you like to do, only you do it for God. Yeah. You allow God to express himself through you. Do you understand when that happens, the world has never seen a move of God like this? Absolutely powerful. So this 40-day fast is to restore the daily sacrifice. It's restoring the 12 tribes. How many understands? I've been trying. I remember in Africa, I taught, Reverend Connie and I was there in Africa, 600 pastors, leaders, and I taught them the tabernacle. And I taught it with a living tabernacle. I had some of the bishops and the pastors right up on the big stage, and they were the living tabernacle, and I was building them. I've been teaching this for a long time. Today is the day we have to let this become life in our life. So, restoring the 12 tribes, restoring the marketplace ministry, but that marketplace ministry teaching is a little shady. How many understands what I mean about the marketplace? You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. And yeah. The true church now is going to be lifted up. Like I say, I saw today 3.5 years ago. Are you ready? God's drawn on a line. I start seeing the different things on both sides of the line. Sheep, goats. You with me? Yeah. Then he's cutting on the line. Yeah. Now he's separating the pages. Yes? And now this page, the only word I had about the apostolic outlook for this year, I didn't even give it. He just gave me one phrase. I'm going to burn that page. I didn't even think I could get a sermon out of that. But then again, I guess it's a sermon in a sentence. I'm gonna burn that page. And then I'm gonna lift this page up to the world and say, this is me. Here's my sheep. Here's my wise virgins. Here's my light. Here's my believers. If you look at this, this is my body. Huh? Sons, not slaves. Here they are, right here. This is what I look like. And now the world is going to see the church for the first time. Not the church that is crooked through the week. Not the church that cusses through the week. Not the church that, are you with me? That's doing everything the world is doing. God, and see, that was the other thing. When God told me on that 40-day fast 3.5 years ago, he says, son, people are looking for me at church. And they're saying no to me. But he said, that's not me they're saying no to. And that hurts me. I don't want them saying no to me. And it's not even me. They're not really saying no to me. They're saying something no that I'd say no to. So, Bill, I need you to raise up a church that looks like me. I said, okay. So for 3.5 years, I've been a little hard on you. Been a little in your face. But God's going to lift up this remnant, this first fruits at Passover and say, here's the first fruits. Here's what God looks like right here. Amen. Now what's going to happen to that other page? They're going to burn. And not until just, I don't know, a few days ago did I understand what burn means. They're going to burn with shame. They're going to burn with disappointment. They're going to burn with, I could have. They're going to burn with, I missed it. They're going to burn with anger. They're going to burn with jealousy. That's what's going to happen. Why? Because they could have been on the other page. Will they be destroyed? That's the thing I couldn't totally figure out. No, they won't be destroyed, but their temple is destroyed. I mean, they're no good for God. If you're angry and you're jealous and you're disappointed and you missed it and you see, the tough thing for a lot of people is to repent and come back. They'd rather stay away than come back because they're ashamed. How many's doing okay? Turn to somebody and say, thank God Bishop's brought us this far. Yeah, I think I got another slide. Length of fast. So I'm calling everybody on a 40-day fast. Are you ready? Say yes. The Judas says hallelujah. All right. I want you to decide one of these. Now, because this is not my fast, this is your fast. That means there are more of you. Say amen as we go along. Say, oh, thank God there's more of us. See, because when it was just Bishop, it was just Bishop. But see, now the body is fasting. How many understands we got a shot at, if there's enough of you, you only have to fast one day and we got 40 days covered. Perfect, the cameraman said. Hallelujah. All right, here's the different fasts in the Bible. I put it on a slide. The reason the whole PowerPoint was for this slide alone. One night. Yes, you can fast one night. I'm saying, sign me up for that one. This was King Darius. I don't know. While you're writing these down, I'll mention it. King Darius put Daniel in the fiery furnace and said, man, I wished I hadn't have done that. And he literally fasted for Daniel. Here's this king that fasted for Daniel. He just had to fast one night. Next morning, he was right out there seeing what was going to happen. Yeah. Amen. One day. Everybody say one day. One day does not mean for morning and then eat at night. It does include 24 hours. Minister Ryan called me and he said, write me down for 40 one day, consecutive one days. I text back and said, does that mean you're just not going to eat during the day and you're going to eat each night? That's not even a day. You have 40 consecutive no days, you know. Anyway, children of Israel fasted one day, Nehemiah 9:1, Jeremiah 36:6. Cornelius fasted one day. Cornelius, Acts chapter 10, verse 30, gets a vision out of one day. It's not the length of the fast, and it's not how long you go hungry. It's obedience is where the thing is, and it's just shutting your flesh off long enough that you refocus on something else. 3 days. This is a famous one, 3 days. Esther and all the people of God. She said her handmaidens, and all the children of Israel. That was what? During Purim. That was going to be destroyed. She fasted. Esther 4:16. That 3-day fast turned a whole nation around. This 3-day fast saved an entire nation. Powerful, amen? Apostle Paul, Acts 9 and 9, 3-day fast. 7 days, everybody say 7 days. That was King David, 2 Samuel 12, 16 through 20. It was, you know, it was his son died, and he fasted for 7 days. And, you know, came out of a little sin. The wages of sin is death. And so, you see, this 7-day fast was like almost, I'm sorry for what happened. And I wish I coulda, shoulda, woulda. And if there's any grace whatsoever, God, that you can do something about this. 7 days. 14 days. Everybody say 14 days. Apostle Paul and his team on a ship, they fasted for 14 days, 14 nights included. They were saved. The ship was destroyed, but they themselves were saved. Because of that fast, they got the best ship under the armies at that time to escort them to Rome, where Paul was supposed to get to. In other words, he ended up fasting for 14 days and ended up getting on a freight liner, Carnival cruise line, the rest of the way. Amen. Turned out better. 14 days. And all of his team. That's kind of like, you know, Bishop and the team. Yeah, that's a good one. Daniel fasted for 21 days. Everybody say 21 days. Now, this 21 days was not an entire food fast. This was a no dainties, you know, no chocolate chip cookies, no wine, none. So this wasn't a total food fast. It was just a certain kind of food. I might throw in there, while you're trying to figure out what good food would be, it may take you longer to figure all that out than enjoy the fast. You know, reading labels. I mean, can I eat this? Can I not eat this? Blah, blah, blah. You know, that type of thing. You understand what I'm saying? Because that was, you know, pulse. I don't know. Yeah, I'm not sure you're going to go and pick up a pulse-free in the grocery store. So I might submit to you that 21-day could be just a zeal fast. That's all you take for 21 days is zeal. You'll know you're getting good food, and you're saying no to the, what do you got up there? Zeal, okay, zeal for life. That would be a good thing to do. In other words, you're still getting nutrition. Are you with me? But you're not, you know, looking at that big juicy steak and going, shundai, hallelujah. You know, so 21 days. And then 40 days. Everybody say 40 days. It's a possibility for all of you. When I went on a 40-day fast, the first one, I was milking cows. I was a dairy farmer. I was milking cows. People say, well, I work. I was milking cows. I wasn't sitting at a desk. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah, there goes your excuse. Now, I will have to tell you, along about 28, 29, I thought I was going to fall headfirst into the gutter, because after you bend over and take the milkers off cows, raise up, take, put the milkers on, raise up, walk up, carry a milker, ho! Yeah, I mean, sometimes when you come up, the world revolves around you a couple of laps, you know? And so I remember some days, I thought maybe I was just going to end up in the gutter, you know, underneath the cow. I don't know. There were days. Are you with me? I was looking forward to milking being done and then go sit in the tractor and just scoop poop. You know, that wasn't too bad, you know? 40 days. So don't tell me you can't do it. Yeah. But then don't try to be super spiritual and say, I'm going to do that. Yeah. It's God is calling you for that. So there you go. That's where they were at. Exodus, obviously, 40-day fast for Moses. Got him the entire Torah, the first five books of the Bible. We already have those. You may not need to fast for those. Yeshua fasted for 40 days. He was the Son of God. He was the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. You may not have to do that. I had to pioneer not only an evangelistic ministry, I had to pioneer a church, and I've had to pioneer the last move of God. You may not have to do that. I've already done that. Don't reinvent the wheel. Are you okay? Yeah. All right. So here it is. Let's ease into this thing. I want you to try fasting between meals. Did that lighten it up a little bit? Did we do good? Now, I don't want to be unkind or anything, but some of you could lose 40 pounds and it not hurt. Riley, if he loses 40 pounds, man, maybe you ought to stick with the 21 zeal thing, you know, hallelujah. But let's just ease into this thing. Let's just fast between meals. I mean, let's not make this super spooky spiritual. This is not Lent. We're not talking about giving up something for God. No, that's not it. Let's ease into this. Let me give you seven good reasons not to fast. These are taken from the Book of Opinions. Chapter 4. I don't have one of those with me. It did not get canonized, but the Book of Opinions is still well read today. The first one is, well, I need to use wisdom. That's absolutely, I agree with you. You need to use wisdom. You know, you just can't run off on a 40-day fast and drink beer. I mean, you need to use wisdom. But I don't know. I look at that, and my only question is, well, where are you getting the wisdom from? Man, who told you this wisdom? I mean, I just want you to know, you're not going to die if you skip a meal or two, contrary to what somebody may have told you. So I need to use wisdom. Absolutely. But, you know, try this wisdom. I've already tried to give you some good advice, wisdom. Last Sabbath. Number two, well, I have diabetes and I must eat to control my blood sugar. Well, that's a good reason. But then another doctor out there talks about the 16-hour fast or whatever. And if you just don't eat from, if you only eat from 12 to 5 and you fast 16 hours, it'll actually reset your blood sugar. So fasting does do something for your blood sugar. It's tough, but somebody told you don't do that. And that's a good reason not to. I have diabetes. And so I want diabetes more than I want God. Okay, moving on. Well, number three, good reason. Well, the medication from the pharmacy, which is called pharmakia, which is another word for witchcraft, says that I must not take that medication on an empty stomach. Well, that's a good reason. Because I'd hate for you to throw up that medication. Because that's not going to do any good. I mean, you take that witchcraft and then you immediately throw it up. What was the sense of that? I mean, you paid good insurance money for that. I mean, that's a reason not to do that. Amen? Because I want my meds more than God. No, I mean, just think about it. Just take your pills out and set them on the floor and get down on your hands and knees and just worship them for a moment. And say, O Most High Meds, you are my provider, you are my deliverer, you are my healer. And then pick them up and take them. And say no to fasting, which God talked about. All right. Oh, I'm just giving you like the other of you. Okay. Number four, I work and get lightheaded. Well, some of you are lightheaded and you don't work. I get sick. Well, throw up and prove it. Now, don't you feel better? I get lightheaded. Well, that's a good reason. It's a good reason. Amen. Number five is, well, yes, but the Bible says, here's where the religious people come in. The Bible says as long as the bridegroom is with us, we don't fast. That's true. Jesus said that. I don't know if you're aware or not that he's not here. Just saying. Well, he lives in my heart. Well, I didn't know that Jesus had already returned. And you're the only one that he returned to. No, my Bible says he's still seated at the right hand of the Father and he is coming again. And it very well may be very soon. But no, friends, he doesn't live in your heart. Well, I asked Jesus to come into my heart. Uh-huh. Well, a 5'9" Jewish man does not step inside your blood pump. Let's get the gospel squared away. What you ask in your life is the Word. His flesh being in you is, you already got flesh. You don't need any more flesh. You need the Word. Everybody say the Word. Now, Jesus is, he is the bridegroom. He is coming back. He's not here right now. Jesus himself said, when the bridegroom is with you, you don't fast. It was a discussion about fasting amongst the disciples. And Jesus says, well, my disciples don't fast because I'm here with them. But there'll come a time where they'll fast. And when's that time? Hello? That would be right now. All right. Here's another good reason not to fast. Well, I live a fasted life. You are the most spiritual person that I have ever run into. I live a fasted life. So what you're saying is then, when you walk into Walmart, people get healed instantly because of the glory of God that's around you. You walk about a foot off the ground, you live a fasted life. You prophesy, flow in signs, wonders, and miracles every day of your life. You live a fasted life. Let me tell you what you fast. You fast church attendance most of the time that I see. You've been fasting the prayer call. You've been fasting the Sabbath teaching. You've been fasting witnessing. I see you fast giving offerings. I see you fast a lot of things. Yes, you truly do live a fasted life. See, these super spiritual people should make you sick to your stomach after a while. We're not talking about drawing attention to ourselves for crying out loud. We're trying to get God in our life. We're just trying to get God in our life here. If you want a reason not to fast, let me give you the best one, number seven. Skip through 1-6 and just get to number seven and say this with me, I don't want to. See, this will be the honest one. This is actually a real reason. God can accept this. Amen. I don't want to. Well, all right. End of story. Burn. No, I'm sorry. Okay. I want God more than that. Now, here's the two things I want all of you to pick a food fast, one of those, one night, one day, 3 days, 7 days, 14 days, 21 days. I don't expect any of you to do the 40 day unless you're just really way out there and want God more than your life. But I'd like each of you to pick one of those. However, this whole 40 days, I want you to have this thought in your mind, I want God more than that. Say that. I want God more than that. The question is, what is your that? I want God more than pop. I should go through each one of these. We don't have buy a meal afterwards. We can just eat on all this stuff for a while. Instead of buying a pop, take the time that it would take to go get the pop, the time that it would take to drink the pop, and spend that praying. Then bring the $10.50 that it costs for pop nowadays for sugar fix, and give it as an offering. Candy. I want God more than candy. I want God more than TV. Take your TV time and give it to God. I mean, that's a two-hour movie. 2 hours in prayer? What? What? No, you're not. My body's not the temple of the Holy Ghost yet. I've got some personal time that I take. Okay, I want God more than entertainment. Or I want God more than food. I want God more than junk food. See, Judah is responding to several of these good things here. I want God more than that habit, whatever that habit is. I mean, just quit picking your nose for 40 days. Gossip, how about that? I want God more than gossip. Now, where's most gossip at? Gossip. It's found everywhere. You can pick up a batch of this gossip just about anywhere. Say, I want God more than that. So I'm going to what? Fast gossip. See, what I'm trying to say is you could fast gossip for 40 days and revolutionize your life. You could not eat for 40 days and lose 40 pounds and, you know, hate me for the rest of your life. How about fasting, saying I can't for 40 days? For 40 days, I'm not going to say I can't because. Uh-oh. How about Instagram? Fast Instagram for 40 days. See, Snapchat, fast it for 40 days. Some of you old people don't even know what Instagram is and Snapchat. Oh, because you're still into Facebook, that's why. Facebook is for old people. Instagram is where the young people went to get away from the old people. Snapchat is so you can take a selfie and send it to somebody that you can't do on Twitter. So why don't you fast arguing for 40 days? Just say, you know, I just can't argue with you. I'm fasting that for 40 days. That'll get a response. How about complaining? I mean, don't complain for 40 days. Do you understand you could lose 40 pounds just on that right there? I'm going to fast criticizing for 40 days. How many's getting some ideas? How many's thinking of actually fasting a few of these things for 40 days? Oh, my God. Okay. How about criticizing? Oh, man, I'll let somebody else fast that one. How about credit card? Just leave your credit card in your wallet for 40 days. Do not buy anything on credit for 40 days. Pay cash only for 40 days. Well, not at Replace Takes American Express. I like this one, procrastination. I'm going to fast procrastinating. I recommended this one to someone that I know. Fast the snooze button for 40 days. That means when the alarm goes off, just get up and pray for the 10 minutes that you would snooze. I want God more than snooze. How about fast being late? Fast being late. There's some people that are late on time, or I mean being late is there on time. That is super selfish. That just makes you think you're more important than everybody else. Fast that. That's a good character building thing. A Facebook. We already talked about that. That's for old people anyway. If you're young, you shouldn't even be on this crazy thing. Twitter. Unless you're signed up, you know, with the president getting his twits. Selfies. How about this? Fast selfies for 40 days. Take your camera and your phone and set it the opposite direction so you cannot take a picture of yourself for 40 days. In other words, quit thinking about yourself for 40 days. And if you don't take a selfie, then you can probably fast Instagram and Snapchat for 40 days. And while it takes the time to do that, standing in front of a shark or a camel that's going to bite your head off, or a ravine that you're going to fall into, saying, the world wants to see me. No, they don't. God, if you fasted for 40 days, you'll realize the world will go on without them seeing you. Fasted for 40 days, and the time it takes to take one of these pictures, the time it takes to post one, the time it takes to go look and see how many likes you got, you could spend that actually praising God, praying, and your life would be changed, and you might, after 40 days, get to the point of, you know, it's not about me, and be delivered from the thing altogether. Now actually start witnessing for God and wanting people to see God and not you. Are you against selfies? Yeah, it's pretty nauseating. Look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. Now, I've been looking at you. I haven't seen anything yet. I've been looking at you and you're getting older. I got a new profile, right? Because no one would recognize you anymore in that other profile. How many's got this list down? How many can think of a couple more? All right, praise God. All right, so I'm declaring a 40-day fast. Everybody fast a that for 40 days. Everybody fast a that for 40 days. How many will say yes? I will fast one of those that's for 40 days. Everybody, I want you to choose one of the food fasts, whether it's just one night, one day, 3 days, 7 days, 14, 21, 40. Just choose one of those, all right? Is that fair? Yeah. I mean, how many knows? I mean, you can just fast one night. Just skip the evening meal. How many knows? Everybody can probably do that. Just get home after 5 o'clock and say, well, you know, I can't eat after 5 because even the world's wisdom says that. So I've got two or more touching anything agreeing. What time can I get up in the middle of the night to have a snack? No, you have to fast between meals. put a lock on the refrigerator. And then I want you to write your name on the calendar. This will be a calendar that will be back there on that counter. We have some ministers that's already signed up for certain days here. We just want you to write your name on this calendar for a food fast. Not so don't write your name on here all 40 days for gossip. Okay, that's your own personal thing. We do not, in fact, I don't think I even want to know what you're fasting for 40 days. I think that'll just be between you and God, okay? There's some things I just can't handle. There's some things I know and some things God does not show me because he loves me. You remember that kid in that movie, you know? I see dead people. See, I don't want to see some things, you know? So I want you to write your name on this calendar for the food fast. So you say, okay, I'm going to fast 3 days. Write down the 3 days that you are going to fast that. How many thinks it's going to be just wonderful to see that we've got a team that fills up these 40 days and that we want God more than that? Yeah. Amen? So write your name on the calendar. And then don't forget to decide the why of your fast. You don't have to write that on the calendar, but you have to write that in your own thinking or write it down on a piece of paper when you're one day into that fast and say, my God, why was I doing this? You'll need to remember. Okay? And do not write, Bishop said so. That is not... that is not one of the reasons, you know. The... bottom line is there's different reasons for fast, and so praise God for that. Yes? Did you get anything out of this today? Wasn't this a great day? Amen. So decide the why of your fast. You're fasting for souls to come. You're fasting for, you know, whatever you're fasting for. Okay, I guess I did all of them there. Praise God. So why are we doing this? We believe that we're going to end up at Passover, that we believe that we will be counted worthy to escape those things that are coming on the earth. If world war breaks out, somehow we're going to be given wings of an eagle to fly into a safe place, which is probably Sandusky, Michigan, because no one cares about this place. ISIS is probably not, this isn't ISIS's hit list here, you know? I wouldn't say Washington's a good place. I wouldn't say L.A. is all that good. There's a few places I would consider snip-dingle getting away from, you know. Let's pray that we will be the two witnesses going into this harvest season. We're going to go into the 30, 60, 100, the spring harvest, the wheat harvest, and the grape harvest. We're going to have three harvest seasons. How many wants to be ready to be those witnesses that brings in that harvest? Amen. All right, I love you. Praise God. I think we're going to sing our way out of here. Maybe, I don't know.